Alicia.
One of the problems, one of the reasons for the breakdown of the trading system, the world trading system as I described, which the president is trying to fix, in the last 20 some odd years, we've seen a lack of discipline. Tariff, non-tariff barriers have gone up. There has been a lot of protectionism. The United States, by the way, we have the lowest average tariff in the world. And if you go down a laundry list of industries, you will see we are much lower. Our tariff rates are much lower than our competitors.
It doesn't look like Canada will be celebrating a new NAFTA deal anytime soon. For the last month, negotiations between the U.S. and Mexico have been heating up without Canada. And now President Trump is suggesting Canada is being deliberately frozen out of trade talks. But as our Ottawa Bureau Chief Mercedes Stevenson explains, the Canadian government says that isn't the case.
Surrounded by his cabinet in the White House, U.S. President Donald Trump once again took aim at Canada.
Canada is charging us a lot of money to bring their timber down into our country.
Trump took a swipe at Canada in NAFTA negotiations too, implying his northern neighbor has been sidelined.
We're not negotiating with Canada right now. Their tariffs are too high, their barriers are too strong, so we're not even talking to them right now. We'll see how that works out. It'll only work out to our favor.
The rebuke comes after the U.S. and Mexico have been negotiating alone at the table for the past 4 weeks, raising concerns for some that Canada is being cut out. The government insists there's nothing to worry about, saying Minister Freeland, Ambassador McNaughton, and the Canadian negotiating team are in regular contact with their counterparts. Our focus remains on defending Canadian interests as we work towards a modernized, updated NAFTA agreement. Former Foreign Affairs Minister John Manley says Trump has used tough talk before to get his way.
I think that he is a New York real estate developer who is always trying to get a better deal. And this negotiation for him is not about building a win-win outcome.
Manley and others are warning the government should lower expectations to prepare the Canadian public for the possibility of no deal.
Across Canada, the cost of living is on the rise. New numbers today show prices climbing for just about everything except paychecks. CTV's Omar Sachedina has more.
If you feel like the basics are getting more expensive, that's because they are.
The 3% number is going to be a surprise.
Higher than what analysts were predicting.
There are a large number of risks out there. The continuing worries about tariffs, the concerns about the NAFTA negotiations.
The major culprits behind the higher cost of living, gas prices, airline tickets, restaurant food, and mortgage interest costs, leaving many feeling like they're living paycheck to paycheck.
Oh, 100% I am right now.
Everything is expensive.
Rent is like goes up, and I mean, you're not making more money necessarily.
Among the provinces, Alberta's annual cost of living increase is the highest at 3.5%. BC, Saskatchewan, Manitoba, Ontario, and PEI are also above the national average. Below it, Newfoundland and Labrador, Nova Scotia, New Brunswick, and Quebec. Statistics Canada says tariffs from the cross-border trade rift with the United States haven't triggered higher prices for consumers yet, but grocery chains Metro and Sobeys have warned shoppers of potentially higher prices. And companies that use cans like Campbell Company of Canada and Molson Coors say they too are considering price hikes to offset rising costs of aluminum and steel.
Where they are U.S. goods that you like, if it's a U.S. jam or it's a U.S. coffee or U.S. whiskey or orange juice, what you need to do is look for potential alternatives.
And while the cost of living is increasing, wages aren't keeping up. A crushing combination, especially for younger Canadians paying off student debt.
Today's young person has to work, you know, something like 13 years of full-time work to save a 20% down payment on an average priced home, whereas someone 4 decades ago only had to work 5.
At 3%, inflation is at the top end of the Bank of Canada's target range.
First, I'd like to thank Prime Minister Trudeau for hosting this summit. It has worked out to be so wonderful. The people of Canada are wonderful, and it's a great country and a very beautiful country, I might add. We tackled a variety of issues and opportunities facing our nations. At the top of the list was the issue of trade. Very important subject because the United States has been taken advantage of for decades and decades, and we can't do that anymore. We had extremely productive discussions on the need to have fair and reciprocal, meaning the same. People can't charge us 270% and we charge them nothing. That doesn't work anymore. Okay, question? Yes.
Excuse me. You said that this was a positive meeting, but from the outside it seemed quite contentious. Did you get any indication from your interlocutors that they were going to make any concessions to you? And I believe that you raised the idea of a tariff-free G7. Is that?
I did. Oh, I did. That's the way it should be. No tariffs, no barriers. That's the way it should be. And no subsidies. I even said no tariffs. In other words, let's say Canada, where we have tremendous tariffs. The United States pays tremendous tariffs on dairy, as an example, 270%. Nobody knows that. We pay nothing. We don't want to pay anything. Why should we pay? We have to, ultimately, that's what you want. You want a tariff-free, you want no barriers, and you want no subsidies, because you have some cases where countries are subsidizing industries, and that's not fair. So you go tariff-free, you go barrier-free, you go subsidy-free. That's the way you learned at the Wharton School of Finance. I mean, that would be the ultimate thing. Now, whether or not that works, but I did suggest it, and people were, I guess they're going to go back to the drawing board and check it out, right? But we can't have an example where we're paying, the United States is paying 270%. Just can't have it. And when they send things into us, you don't have that. I will say it was not contentious. What was strong was the language that this cannot go on. But the relationships are very good, whether it be President Macron or with Justin. Justin did a really good job. I think the relationships were outstanding. But because of the fact that the United States leaders of the past didn't do a good job on trade, and again, I'm not blaming countries, I'm blaming our people that represented our past. It's going to change. It's going to change. I mean, it's not a question of, I hope it changes. It's going to change 100%. And tariffs are going to come way down because people cannot continue to do that. We're like the piggy bank that everybody's robbing, and that ends. In fact, Larry Kudlow is a great expert on this, and he's a total free trader. But even Larry has seen the ravages of what they've done with their tariffs. Would you like to say something, Larry, very quickly? Might be interesting.
Well, one interesting point in terms of the G7 group meeting, I don't know if they're surprised with President Trump's free trade proclamation, but they certainly listened to it, and we had lengthy discussions about that. As the president said, reduce these barriers. In fact, go to zero. Zero tariffs, zero non-tariff barriers, zero subsidies. And along the way, we're going to have to clean up the international trading system, about which there was virtual consensus of agreement on that. And that will be a target. And these are the best ways to promote economic growth. We'll all be better at it. We'll all be stronger at it. So I myself was particularly gratified to hear my president talk about free trade. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Larry.